School at the Bishop's School, and very proudly so. And it is my pleasure to welcome you this evening to the Geyer Family Presentation Hall and to the presentation of Dr. Robert Dallek, who was the school's inaugural endowed scholar in residence. Since Dr. Dallek's first appearance at Bishop's 6 years ago, he has returned several times and met with groups of students, continuing to instruct and inform them as only a true historian can. Today's discussions with our students included reflections upon the nature of the presidency and effective leadership. And I can think of no better lesson for the budding citizens and leaders themselves of tomorrow. It was, in fact, during my predecessor's time, that of Mike Teitelman, head of school of bishops, that we received a remarkable gift from a family that has allowed us to fund several key programs, including the Endowed Scholar in Residence program. And I would love to recognize this evening former headmaster Michael Teitelman and Marlene Teitelman. We have been honored and fortunate to welcome and learn from several other scholars in residence, seven men and women who represent the brightest academic leaders in fields of the sciences, arts, humanities, and social sciences. In late February of this year, the students and school community will benefit from the creativity and artistry of this year's endowed scholar in residence, Nicholas Cripple, a noted sculptor who lives on the East Coast. I would like to welcome, and please join me, Dr. Jeffrey Gagan, Chair of the History and Social Sciences Department, who, along with faculty members Rich Del Rio and Kirk Ankeny, was instrumental in organizing Dr. Dallek's day on campus today and this evening tonight. So please welcome.
It is my distinct privilege and honor to introduce our special guest tonight, Dr. Robert Dallek. Dr. Dallek is a world-renowned scholar of American history and the American presidency. During his illustrious career, he's taught at Columbia University, Oxford, UCLA, Boston University. In fact, I realized that I was at Boston College when he was at Boston University, which was when the Red Sox broke the 86-year curse.
Had nothing to do with us.
maybe I bring that up in part to say, turn off all electronic devices. Series right now. Okay, good. He was also at Dartmouth and is currently at a professor at Stanford University's campus in Washington, D.C., where he resides with his wife, Jerry, and within close proximity, I found out last night, his two adult children, Matthew and Rebecca, and their families, including another grandchild on the way. So, yes. Beyond his teaching accomplishments, Dr. Dallek is an elected fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Society of American Historians, where he served as president from 2004 to 2005. He's authored numerous important and groundbreaking works, including a book on Franklin Delano Roosevelt and his foreign policy, which was awarded the prestigious Bancroft Prize. A two-volume work on Lyndon B. Johnson, still considered one of the most definitive works on LBJ's life and presidency. A book looking into the complex relationship between Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger, which was a Pulitzer Prize finalist. Not the relationship, but his book. And several books on John F. Kennedy, including his 2003 An Unfinished Life, which was a New York Times bestseller, and which brought to light many previously unknown details of JFK's personal life and severe health problems, details unknown even to many of JFK's closest associates and family members. In fact, I think I heard an anecdote that Teddy Kennedy didn't believe half the things in your book until he saw the medical records. And most recently, Dr. Dallek just published this month, Camelot's Court, which you may have seen outside, in which there'll be opportunity to purchase the book, Inside the Kennedy White House, which looks at the behind-the-scenes workings of Kennedy's inner circle of advisors as they grappled with foreign and domestic crises such as the failed Bay of Pigs invasion, the Cuban Missile Crisis, civil rights unrest at home, and growing Vietnam conflict abroad. Because of Dr. Dallek's vast expertise, he's a frequent commentator on radio and television, including NPR, CNN, and NBC, and all the more so with the upcoming 50th anniversary of JFK's assassination. Dr. Dallek has had a very full schedule over the past couple of months, and is booked through November and beyond, I'm sure. And so we're very fortunate to have him here with us tonight. But this speaks of Dr. Dallek's commitment to education in general, and his special relationship with the Bishop's School in particular. He served as Bishop's inaugural scholar-in-residence, as we just heard, and has since visited us on numerous occasions, truly inspiring our students, in which I saw that again today, with his careful and creative scholarship, and perhaps more importantly, his care and concern for our students as individuals, whom he knows must learn from the past that they will effectively lead in the future. And for all this, Dr. Dallek, we are extremely grateful. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Robert Dallek.
Many thanks, Jeff. That's a wonderful introduction. And it's always a pleasure to be back at the Bishop's School. It's really a very special place. And I've learned over the years through my association here with not just the faculty and administrators, with Michael and AC, but the students. See? She's only affirming what I'm saying. they're wonderful young people. And I met with four different groups of them today. And I was saying before that it gives you hope for the country for the future. Because you see these intelligent, interested young people. They're so engaged with matters relating to larger public issues. And they asked some wonderful questions. Here are kids who are in the 8th grade, 10th grade, and they were asking me some really searching questions that you might expect from a mature journalist or other scholar. Anyway, what I want to talk about this evening is John Kennedy's hold on the public here in the United States and around the world. 50 years next month, since, of course, he was assassinated. Before I came here, I ran into my dear friend, Jeff Kelman, who is a brilliant physician, who helped me with my research at the Kennedy Library when I was working on An Unfinished Life. And Jeff had gotten hold of this new book, Camelot's Court, and he said to me, Bob, I'm really enjoying this book. I hope it has a better ending. And so it put me in mind of the anecdote about my son, who when he was about 4 years old, and he's a historian now, teaches at the university level for the University of California. When he was about 4 years old, he said to me one day, Daddy, you're a doctor, aren't you? I said, well, yeah, but not like your doctor, not like your pediatrician. And he said, oh, I know that, because you're also an historian. Well, I was delighted he could make this distinction at so early an age, but then he wanted to know, does that mean that you make people in the past feel better? So I thought of that when Jeff said to me, I hope this book has a different ending. Let me talk about this extraordinary phenomenon, which I would call the John F. Kennedy hold on the country. In 2003, when I finished writing An Unfinished Life, I lived by the proposition that you write a book to forget a subject, see? You ask certain questions, and then you want to move on. But somehow or other, I couldn't let go of Kennedy, because he was omnipresent. The polls, the information, the constant drumbeat of discussion about him. Indeed, since he died, polls consistently rated him as one of the five greatest presidents in American history. And there was a recent poll which said he is the most admired president since Eisenhower in 1953. There was a Gallup poll about 2 years ago, and they asked Americans to assess the last nine presidents from John Kennedy to George W. Bush. Kennedy came in number one with an 85% approval rating. 85%. The only one within hailing distance of him was Ronald Reagan with 74%. And this seems to just continue this extraordinary hold that he has on the public and, as I'll show you in a moment, around the world. There have been, believe it or not, 40,000 books published about John Kennedy in the 50 years since he was killed. 40,000 books. So many of them, of course, on the assassination. I'm happy to talk a little bit about that and give you my view on there. In fact, on this anniversary occasion, there are 8 new assassination books apparently out or coming out. There's also a host of TV documentaries. PBS is doing 4 hours in the American Experience series on WGBH out of Boston. The National Geographic Channel is doing 2 hours. CBS has 1 hour. Fox has a documentary division. They're doing 1 hour. And I recently learned that NBC is doing 1 hour. Now, if that's not enough, consider the fact that in Germany, in France, in Great Britain, there are all documentaries appearing about John F. Kennedy. And so the puzzle for the historian is, how could it be that a man who served for only 1,000 days in the White House had the 6th briefest presidency in American history should have this phenomenal hold on the public's imagination, both here and around the world? And add to that the fact that there has been a cascade of debunking writings, every sort of debunking book and article. First of all, the womanizing. Everybody knows that John Kennedy was a world-class womanizer. Speculation about Marilyn Monroe. Now, I must confess, I contributed to this by dint of the fact that when I was doing my research in 2003, I had read an oral history by a woman named Barbara Gammarikian, who was the deputy press secretary with P.S. Salinger at the White House. And there were 17 blacked out pages in this oral history. And I happened to meet her in at a cocktail party in Washington. And I said to her, Barbara, you know, I recently read your oral history, 17 blacked out pages. It's 40 years since Kennedy died. She said, I'll open it to you. Great. I went back to the library the following week and saw the archivist, Megan DeNoyes, and I said, Megan, Barbara says she'll open these 17 pages to me. And she said to me, Bob, do me a favor. Don't make me open it to you. I'll get in trouble with the Kennedys. And so I said to myself, ooh, this must be interesting. And I went back to Barbara, and she let me read the oral history. And what was in there? 17 pages about how Kennedy had this affair with a 19, 20-year-old young woman. She had come to the White House as an intern. Her first day there, he took her to Jackie's bedroom and seduced her, see. And it went on from there for a year and a half. 2 years ago, she published a book, Once Upon a Secret. I've corresponded with her. She's a very nice woman. I didn't know what her name was. And when my book in 2003 was coming out, the New York Daily News called me up and they said, who's this woman? I said, you know, I don't know. Barbara didn't want to tell me. And she must be 60 years old. Leave her alone. You know, who cares at this point? I trust that Barbara's telling the truth. Well, journalists being journalists, they chase this lead down and they found out who she was because she had been a graduate of Miss Porter's school, the same school Jackie Kennedy had gone to, see. And so for 3 days running after that, the New York Daily News published headlines. Kennedy's Monica, because this was at the time of the Bill Clinton affair. And to top that, on page 3 the first day, they had a picture of Monica Lewinsky and of me. As I told my wife, I don't even know the woman. You can get in a lot of trouble being a historian, I found out. So there's all this literature about his womanizing. On top of that, there's now a rich literature about his cover-up of his health problems. And again, I was the first one to get into his health records. There was a 3-person committee. I urged them to open the records. They had never been available to biographers or historians, journalists before. There was a Harvard professor, a Yale professor, they agreed to let me in as a serious scholar. Ted Sorensen didn't want to open them. And so I went to New York to meet with him. Now, you know, I've not been studying these politicians all these years for nothing. I talked him into letting me see these records. And I went to Boston with my friend Jeff Kelman. They rolled out this cart with 10 cardboard boxes. Presidential papers are usually kept in these beautifully appointed red and blue and gold boxes, and here were these old beat-up cartons. And I said to Jeff, I think we've hit pay dirt. And sure enough, we opened it up and we found out that in the 50s, what was hidden from the public was that Kennedy had been hospitalized 9 times for 44 days, twice for a week, several times for 2 or 3 days. And we had the health records with the medications he was taking. And it was startling because he was someone who belied the public image of him as so young and robust, healthy, playing touch football. Of course, he had Addison's disease. He had something called spastic colitis. They began, because his father could afford to purchase this medication, they began giving him steroids in 1937. And they resulted in, they overdosed, they didn't have a dose. And it caused this terrible back problem, osteoporosis of the lumbar spine. And people thought that it was a football injury, the accident when his PT boat was cut in half and he had to swim to an island and save his crew. But it was the steroids which really produced this terrible back condition, which he lived with the rest of his life, you see. And there was a cover-up of this. Now, what I argued in that first book was that, you know, he was really quite courageous. And both Ted Kennedy and Arthur Schlesinger were very responsive to that point. That, forget the cover-up, look at the fact that he performed so brilliantly during so many of the crises he's faced that his presidency was one crisis after another. And he performed brilliantly. But Ted Sorensen was not happy with the fact that I did say there was a cover-up. And forever thereafter, when I saw him, he would say to me, there was no cover-up. Well, I never argued with him, because what was the point? So the womanizing, the health problems, and then the debunking went on about his presidential record. On the domestic side, there were 4 major initiatives. A big tax cut, federal aid to education, Medicare, and of course in 1963, the Civil Rights Bill. None of them passed during his lifetime. It was Lyndon Johnson who got all those bills through. Foreign policy. The debunkers attacked him, criticized him for the fact that he had allowed the Bay of Pigs operation to go forward, quoting him constantly as having said, how could I have been so stupid to have allowed such an operation to go on? How could I have been so taken in by the CIA and the Joint Chiefs of Staff telling me that this would succeed, you see. The struggle over Cuba continued, the debunkers point out. There was Operation Mongoose, in which they tried to assassinate Castro and continued to try and find ways to subvert his administration. They also point to the meeting in Vienna with Khrushchev, in which Khrushchev beat up on him unmercifully. They point to the fact that on Vietnam, when he came to the presidency where there were 600 military advisors, and when he died, he had increased the number to 16,700, which they argue opened the way for Lyndon Johnson to become deeply enmeshed in that conflict. And so there is this whole debunking literature, and yet, it's like water off a duck's back. It has not really impacted his standing with the country and the world. And the question I come back to is, why not? Why does he have this hold on so many Americans? Why is he so appealing? My answer is as follows. First off, there was, of course, the assassination. And I don't think the country has gotten over this yet. It's such a blow to the country's self-esteem, to its amour propre, the feeling that this is not the way we conduct politics in this country. It was such a horror and remains, I think, among people the feeling that it was not just a terrible deed, but such a blow to the country's sense of self-regard. Now, I don't think the assassination alone can possibly account for why he's so appealing to people. Consider the following. William McKinley, popular president, elected to a second term in 1900. In September 1901, he was assassinated. 50 years after McKinley was killed, hardly anybody remembered who he was. And here we are 50 years later, and Kennedy is this heroic figure. The womanizing, people don't care about it. It just doesn't resonate with the public. It doesn't bother them. On the health side, I think they share the perspective that I had, which was that he was quite courageous. I set his medical records and the medications he was taking down alongside the Cuban Missile Crisis, because you know we have tapes of him talking to the XCOM, the executive committee. 13 days, hour by hour, of these conversations. And you cannot see a hint of any medical disability burdening him. He was just so on top of this crisis and performed quite brilliantly. There are substantive achievements which should be remembered, and I think a lot of people do remember them. First of all, he was the first Catholic to be elected to the White House. Would Barack Obama have ever made it to the White House if it weren't for this breakthrough by Kennedy? You see, Kennedy broke the hold of white Protestant males on the presidency. And it won't be long. We'll see a woman as president. I'm not predicting any particular woman now. But you can guess. People remember that he put in place the Peace Corps. It exists to this day, an expression of the highest kind of American idealism. They remember the missile crisis because, as we know now from the records, we never came so close to a nuclear holocaust as during that missile crisis. As Joint Chiefs of Staff, and this is a significant part of what I deal with in this new book, Camelot's Court. I had an article, an excerpt from that book in The Atlantic titled JFK versus the Joint Chiefs. He struggled with them. He battled with them. Because the Joint Chiefs had been the commanders in World War II. And the whole outlook in World War II was you bomb these people back to the Stone Age. Hitler, the Japanese military, and if you're up against a Stalin and a Soviet ruthless regime, you got to think about possibly using nuclear weapons. Kennedy was scared to death of that. Not because he was cowardly, but because he understood that, as he put it, this would be the ultimate failure if you had to get into a nuclear conflict. Indeed, at one point, he said to this young woman, this Mimi, he said to her, and she reports this in her book, Mimi said, I'd rather my kids be red than dead. See, he never could have said that in public, but it was the measure of how determined he was to avoid a nuclear conflict. He fought with them during the missile crisis to turn to diplomacy before you ever took military action. At the end of the missile crisis, he had held the military at arm's length, and then he had a meeting with them. They said to him, Mr. President, you've been had. Khrushchev is hiding those missiles in caves. The White House leaked this to the press, and Khrushchev wrote Kennedy a note saying, I don't live in the caveman era. I'm no caveman, see. Well, Kennedy said, all right, you believe he's hiding them? You make plans to bomb and invade. There are always plans being made. Part of their plan was to drop a 1 megaton nuclear bomb on Cuba. It would have turned the island into a pile of rubble, let alone what it would have done to the south coast of Florida. But they talked about how they could control the collateral damage, the spin-off from using such a weapon. Kennedy thought they were madcap, and he wanted no part of it. And this was, I think, his greatest achievement. He resisted and really got that limited test ban treaty. When he sent Avril Harriman to Moscow to negotiate that, he told Harriman, don't send any of the dispatches to the Pentagon. I don't want these generals seeing that discussion, those discussions, until I have a treaty signed and ready to go to the Senate, see? So the missile crisis, the test ban, civil rights. He was very slow to come to the issue of civil rights, but in 1963, after the crises in Mississippi and Alabama, he said privately, the Southerners keep saying they'll take care of this, but they never will. We have to act. And this civil rights bill that he put before Congress was, I think, an act of political courage, because he and Bobby were convinced that it would jeopardize his reelection in 1964. Remember, he had won by 118,000 votes in 1960, and it was a close-run thing. And if it weren't for Southern votes, Texas, for example, that Johnson brought to the ticket, brought to the election because of Johnson's presence as vice president on the ticket, Kennedy probably would have lost. So they were concerned, but he felt that this was an issue whose time had come. And if you ever listen to that civil rights speech he made, it's one of the really great state papers or speeches by a president, I think, in the 20th century. Finally, on the substantive side, Vietnam. There's lots of evidence that he never would have done what Lyndon Johnson did. He did not want to put ground forces into Vietnam. Yes, he increased the number of advisors. We'll never know what he would have done. I don't think he himself knew what he would have done. Indeed, I love the anecdote. Arthur Schlesinger, Bobby Kennedy, after the election, said to him, Arthur, how would you like to be an ambassador? And Arthur said, no, Bobby, if I do anything, I'd like to go to the White House. A few days later, he saw the president-elect, and Kennedy said to him, so Arthur, I hear you're coming to the White House. And Schlesinger said, I am, what will I do there? And Kennedy said, I don't know, Arthur. I don't even know what I'll be doing there, but you can bet we'll both be busy more than 8 hours a day. It was a true word said in jest, because he was a pragmatist, a practical, or as he put it, he was a realistic idealist, see. But I don't think he ever would have put massive ground forces into Vietnam. When George Ball, his Undersecretary of State, said to him, you put 200,000, 300,000 ground troops into Vietnam, put them in those jungles, you'll never hear from them again. And Kennedy said to him, George, you're crazy as hell. Meaning, I take it. Meaning, I wouldn't do that, see. So, why does he have this hold on the public? I don't think it's strictly the assassination or even these substantive things that I, as a historian, make reference to. There's something larger here. What really gives him this hold on the public is that he's remembered as an inspirational leader, see. He's frozen in our minds at the age of 46. Nobody can believe, think, if he were alive today, he'd be 96 years old, see. If he walked into this room now, he'd be familiar. He'd look like one of us, like he was a modern man, see. And people engage with him in that way, and they remember the press conferences, live televised press conference in which he was so charming, so intelligent, so witty, so quick in the repartee with the journalists, you see. So there is this sense that if he had lived, the country would be a different place. Nothing, I think, speaks to his hold on the public. Nothing speaks more than what happened with his successors. Johnson in Vietnam, Nixon in Watergate, you see, Ford's truncated presidency, Jimmy Carter's one term, the two Bushes, George H.W. Bush after one term, George W. Bush leaves under a cloud, Katrina, Iraq, the economic downturn. What they remember about Kennedy, because people don't remember what presidents do. You think people know that Theodore Roosevelt put the Food and Drug Administration into place, or Woodrow Wilson was the architect of the Federal Reserve? They don't remember this. Indeed, did you see that CNN bunch of interviews where they went in the street and they asked people, what do you think of Obamacare? It's socialized medicine. Well, what about the Affordable Care Act? Yeah, well, that's pretty good. H.L. Mencken, to put a fine point on it, H.L. Mencken once said, nobody ever went broke underestimating the intelligence of the public. I don't want to be too harsh. At the end of the day, they do a lot of right things. But Kennedy, alongside of all these successors, and Reagan, are the two men who still hold the public in their hands. They remember Kennedy said it was a new frontier. Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. He promised to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade, and it happened. Reagan said it's morning in America, the pride is back, you see. This is what people remember. And we go through crisis after crisis in this country, and people need to turn to someone, some hero, some leader. And let me conclude by reading to you a quote from the novelist John Dos Passos, who wrote, "In times of change and danger, when there is a quicksand of fear under men's reasoning, a sense of continuity with generations gone before can stretch like a lifeline across the scary present." And that's what Kennedy gives the public. He's a lifeline across the scary present. And I think after this recent government shutdown, if you ask people again, his poll number would probably be up to 90%. Anyway, I love him. He sells books. So I'm happy to answer questions. Tom, please.
How big an impact do you think Joe Kennedy's stroke had on the JFK administration, and to what extent perhaps the end of the administration?
Yeah. You know, Tom, Joe Kennedy, it deeply troubled the president and Bobby because Joe Kennedy had been such a phenomenal, vital person, his success in life, the phenomenal amount of money that he had made. He became one of the richest men in America. And so it shocked both Jack and Bobby. And I think it deepened Jack's feeling that he wasn't going to live a long life. He lived with this sense because, after all, his oldest brother killed in World War II, Kathleen killed in a plane crash in 1948, see? Then, of course, Jack is assassinated, Bobby assassinated, the son killed in a senseless plane accident. See, this is something also which I think gives the Kennedys extraordinary appeal. On the one hand, they are the famous American success story. Up from the bootstraps, so to speak, phenomenal wealth, Irish Catholics from Boston, phenomenally successful. At the same time, they live under a cloud. They're star-crossed. Crisis after crisis, tragedy after tragedy. And people identify with this because everybody has some kind of suffering in their life. And so they admire the Kennedys. See, the Kennedys are America's dynasty. They're America's dynastic family, not the Roosevelts, not the Bushes, see, but the Kennedys. And they have this kind of hold because I think the combination of great success and tragedy. But there was that sense when the father, on the other hand, Tom, the father didn't have much input into the administration. Jack Kennedy thought his father's views on foreign policy were really quite antediluvian. They were really out of off the map, and they kept him on the sidelines during the 1960 campaign because, you know, he had a bad rep because of his ambassadorship, and it wasn't going to help in the campaign. They were very shrewd politicians. Anyone who gets to the White House is pretty darn shrewd. And I would just interject here, as a contemporary note, this guy Cruz. Doesn't mean I like his politics one bit, but it's an amazing performance that in 9 months' time, this guy is all over the front pages and the television. And now, what we didn't mention was I've had dinner 4 times with President Obama. He likes to talk to presidential historians. So in 8, 9, 10, and this year in January, we had dinner with him again. And it's fascinating because, you know, you're sitting there with the president. People ask me afterwards, what did you eat? And I say, how the hell do I remember? I'm sitting next to the president of the United States, and I'm not thinking about what food is on the plate. But at one dinner, he said to us, complained about the Congress. So I said to him, because he's a very serious man, and I've met Clinton, who was very warm and sort of pressed the flesh, but not Obama. Obama is reserved. He has this strong academic side. Anyway, I said to Mr. President, I said, you know, you complain about Congress. I said, I guess you know what Mark Twain said about congressmen. Shook his head. I told him, Mark Twain said, suppose you were a congressman, and suppose you were an idiot, but I repeat myself. He loved it. Yes, sir.
I was wondering, how successful do you think Johnson's passing of domestic policy would have been
without Kennedy?
How successful could Johnson have been without
Kennedy? Yeah, it's a very good question because initially, Johnson, of course, played upon Kennedy's martyrdom. And he got, in 64, he got the tax cut and the Civil Rights Bill passed. And that was in significant part the result of Johnson saying to the public, you honor the president's memory, our martyred fallen president. So, however, if Johnson ran against Goldwater, or if Kennedy had lived and ran against Goldwater, I think he also would have won a big victory. And then Kennedy would have gotten those 4 bills passed because he would have had big majorities in both houses. And Johnson, of course, after 64, had huge 2/3 majorities and was able to put the Great Society in motion. Johnson's a very interesting character. You know, he must spin his grave because that Gallup poll I told you about, Kennedy number one, Reagan number two. At the bottom is Richard Nixon with 25% approval. Second from the bottom, George W. Bush, 47. And poor LBJ, 49%. All these other presidents ahead of him. And, you know, phenomenal stuff that he did, but of course Vietnam hangs over him like a curse. Yes, sir.
Speak to the issue of inspiration versus intent followed by execution.
They are all, of course, quite different. You can be inspiring, and this has been, I think, part of Obama's problem, that he started out very inspirational, very appealing, but one of the problems is if you're there for 6 years, five, 6 years, you begin to lose your hold on the public because you may be well-intentioned and you may be an inspiring speaker, but if there isn't the execution, there isn't the big picture achievement, it erodes your hold on the public. And I think this is a lot of what's happened to Obama. Now, I'm not writing him off by any means. The administration is not over. I think for him, I think what happens with this Affordable Care Act is enormously important. If a year from now, people are saying it just didn't work, it's really going to undermine his standing. If it's working and people are engaged by it, the way they've been engaged by Medicare, for example, it really will boost him, see. But we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens in 2014, because this will be a huge moment for him, too. He did say at one of the dinners, he said, if I have to deal with the Republican Congress in the second term, I'll be doing a lot more in foreign affairs. But that's where they have running room.
I started the book, and you had said that Kennedy was concerned more about his role in foreign affairs.
Yes.
You thought that was the critical issue in his presidency. Meanwhile, civil rights was brewing, and the March on Washington came, and he decided to invite all the participants to the White House.
Yes.
And that kind of propelled things forward? I mean, it was something he had to engage in.
Yeah, well, he was very much a foreign policy president. He used to say, politics can unseat you, but foreign policy can kill you. And he had been very slow, as I said, to come to civil rights, and he put that bill before Congress in June. But when the civil rights leaders told him they were going to do this march on Washington, he and Bobby tried to discourage them from doing it because they were fearful that it would lead to some kind of violence. And they said, if there's violence, it's going to undermine the prospects for that civil rights bill in the Congress, you see. But when they carried off the march so peacefully and so successfully with King's brilliant, inspiring speech, Kennedy then invited them to the White House to congratulate them on what they had achieved, you see. So it was a dynamic business. It was in flux. You know, at the start of his presidency, as I told you, he wasn't sure what he was going to do on something like civil rights. He didn't want it to get in the way of these foreign policy concerns. But of course, he couldn't control events. And so it pushed to the front, to the center of his presidency, and he had to deal with it. Yes?
Can you address the importance of being conscious of your image and image making? Because the Kennedy family was very conscious of that, and they had all these photographs made. I mean, Kennedy was a published author as a young man. Reagan, likewise, was very image
Absolutely.
Conscious, and everything was very staged,
right.
And he had
yep.
Mike Deaver as his producer.
Yep. Yep.
Back then, they had one newspaper generally per city and three TV stations across the country.
Right.
How can any president ever do that again when we've got
sure.
hundreds
sure.
Oh, of
it's,
information
it's,
out
there? It's changed hugely, but you know, the Kennedys were mindful of their public image from the get-go. Joe Kennedy began relying on public relations experts in the 1920s because, and that's why they hid Jack's medical problems. Because they said it could do him no good, no matter what his career was, if it were known that he were sickly, had these medical issues, it would undermine his public image. And but you know, your point is so changed. In 1932, when Franklin Roosevelt ran for president, Herbert Hoover called him a chameleon on plaid. See, if you get the image. He could get away with things that you can't possibly get away with now, you see, because they didn't have the kind of media and the internet, you know, all these cable channels. Roosevelt, there was radio, but he commanded the radio with its fireside chats, and there were newspapers. I always give the example, Franklin Roosevelt on the protective tariff, 1932, was a big issue in this country in the midst of the Depression. And he told his brain trust, the speechwriters, write two speeches, one for high tariff, the other for low tariff. And they go around the country, and in a high tariff area, they give the high tariff speech, low tariff area. And then he got to an area which was mixed. They said, what are we going to do? He said, I'll show you. He got out on that platform, and he gave a speech. At the end of the speech, those in the crowd for high tariff thought he was for high tariff, and those in the crowd for low tariff thought he was for low. And that's the definition of a damn good politician, you see. Can you get away with it now? No. Could Bill Clinton get away with womanizing? I asked journalists, did you know about Kennedy's womanizing? And they said, sure. But you didn't write about it in the mainstream press in the 1960s. It was a very different world. So you.
I've just seen with Hollywood and both presidents' sort of association or yep. proximity to Hollywood and how that, you know, when you say Reagan and Kennedy, yeah. they had that connection.
Celebrity.
Hollywood, yeah. celebrity.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
very close, intimate bond.
Absolutely.
With that system.
Yes.
Which is intensely powerful.
Intensely
us,
powerful. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, and so. Indeed, in many ways, Kennedy is no longer a real person. He's a celebrity.
Exactly. Warhol.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's a. Yes, sir.
I have a question of interest to every student and every parent of student. You made a remark, and you said that you can tell on 15 minutes exposure to a student what that student's academic prospects are. And the question is, how can you tell?
I'm a prophet. No. We were talking before, and I said that I've taught university students for 45 years, and you know, you can tell in broad ways a lot about a student very, very quickly. You see, you have a conversation with them. I mean, these kids come into your office. And I don't know, I mean, it's almost intuitive as to, is this kid going to be a first-rate student? I mean, early in the term, are they going to be serious about their work? Are they going to goof off? Are they going to, now, you know, I can't predict what their careers will be, but I can get a pretty good assessment of them as to the quality of their work as a student. Pretty early on. And there are, of course, some students who are extremely bright, and you pick up on that in a flash because they're so articulate in the way in which they speak. I taught at Oxford for 1 year. It was something called Harmsworth Professor. And I had a seminar with these English students, and they wouldn't talk much. They were very loath to talk. And I would ask colleagues at Oxford, why don't they talk, they're so different from American students. And he said, because it's part of this culture that they don't want to show off, but we would have them write a paper each week, and they had to present the paper. And when they presented those papers, I mean, there were some of these kids, I could already imagine them in the parliament debating, you see. And they were sharp as could be. You know, a lot of these kids now, gosh, I could never compete with them getting into a university. I mean, it's amazing how much more sophisticated they are. Maybe it has to do something with the internet and their exposure to so much that's beyond anything I encountered when I was 18, 19 years old, or 16 or 17 years old. So, I don't know. You know, it's a kind of intuitive thing. And I conclude this point by saying, Can you teach somebody to be a great politician?
No.
No. See? Great politicians, they have a feel. You know, Franklin Roosevelt, Theodore Roosevelt, they didn't have polling data they relied on, but they had an understanding of how to speak to the public, of how to make connections. See? After Roosevelt died, somebody said to Mrs. Roosevelt, "I miss the way your husband used to speak to me about my government." See, on the radio. There was that sort of connection. And it wasn't, he didn't sit there looking at polls. So there's something about politics which is, it's a subjective, intuitive business that some people, you know, Bill Clinton is brilliant at this. Remember that speech he gave at the Democratic Convention last summer? God, the guy commands the stage. It's extraordinary how good he is at that. So you can't teach that. It's something that is intuitive. Yes?
Do you think Kennedy had a grand vision for America?
I think he had a grand vision, which was to try and reach some kind of detente with the Soviet Union, with the communist world. And I think if he lived, we would have gotten there perhaps sooner than we did with Richard Nixon, who was intent on doing that. Because Kennedy had achieved that nuclear test ban treaty. He had bested Khrushchev in the missile crisis. And after the missile crisis, he told his aides, "Do not gloat, because it will just be an embarrassment to them and will inflame our relations." And he, as I said to you, and I emphasize this in this new book, he was so determined to avoid any kind of nuclear confrontation that what he understood was something President Eisenhower understood. These are not usable weapons. And that they lived in an era which was called MAD, M-A-D, Mutually Assured Destruction. So I think his vision was to try and find some kind of larger accommodation in foreign affairs. Yes, ma'am.
Was there anything in Kennedy's time that could be compared to Snowden today?
Well, not someone who, well, yes, actually, come to think of it. Before the Bay of Pigs occurred, there were some journalists, and particularly the editor at the New Republic, the magazine, who learned that this invasion was in the wind. And they talked him out of publishing a story about it, saying that it would be a blow to national security. And if that guy had published that, it would have sort of been like, you know, this Snowden business, you see. But, you know, this issue of government secrecy is another fascinating subject. I mean, historians struggle with this all the time, because you try and get into materials, and I'll tell you, there are, for example, 55 boxes of Robert Kennedy papers that are still locked up in the Kennedy Library. What's in there? There are two tapes from July 19th, 1963. Kennedy talking to Curtis LeMay, Air Force Chief of Staff, and to John McCone, the head of the CIA, talking to them about the test ban treaty. I tried to get into those, they won't open them. Why? I don't know. My guess is that Kennedy and these national security officials are at each other's throats, and that it's quite acrimonious. But eventually, they'll come to hand. What's the point of having this material if... But we've learned so much more. You see, the three presidents who will be studied forever are Kennedy, Johnson, and Nixon. Of course, we have the tapes. The tapes. And so I'll conclude by just telling you my favorite Lyndon Johnson tape story, which will amuse you. Kennedy and Johnson's tapes were made by choice. Kennedy or Johnson would get on the phone and he'd go to a secretary like this meeting, run the tape. Nixon's tapes were voice activated. But there is a Johnson tape in which he calls up the maker of Hagar slacks. And he says to him, "You the fellow that makes them Hagar slacks?" And the guy says, "Yes, Mr. President." And he said, You made me 5 pairs of pants last summer, ticks off the colors. He says, I need 5 more pairs of pants this summer, ticks off the colors. He said, but listen, man, you got to give me more room in the crotch because them pants are cutting my nuts something awful. President of the United States, enshrined in history with this. Why did he make that? He probably forgot the tape was on, but I don't know. Johnson being Johnson, he enjoyed tweaking, you know, and maybe he's laughing somewhere over the fact that we still tell this story about him. Anyway, thanks for being so attentive, and I'll be back sometime.